Hello, I'm Anna Bly. One of the most important achievements of my political career started in 1998 when, as Minister for Families, Youth and Community Care, I established the Ford Inquiry into the abuse of children in Queensland institutions. It shone a light on the shocking and shameful way that our most vulnerable, our youngest children, were entrusted into the care of people in organisations who didn't care at all. Worse still, they allowed physical violence, sexual abuse, and extreme neglect to not only become acceptable, but for many of these children, a part of their everyday lives. The sometimes very confronting docudrama that you're about to watch focuses on one such shameful place. It will take you inside the Westbrook Farm Home for Boys, an isolated institution near Toowoomba in southwest Queensland. 9 former inmates will tell you their stories. They had the misfortune of being sent to Westbrook in the 1950s and early 1960s. The pain and suffering they were forced to endure, both mentally and physically, has scarred them all their lives. This powerful and compelling docudrama is a tribute to their courage and the courage of all those who work to make social change happen.
I'm Alfred Crowe Fletcher. I'm 18. And I'm a free man.
What they did to Australian children up there by Australians is nothing more than disgraceful.
Set in ideal surroundings, just outside Toowoomba on the Darling Downs, is the Westbrook Farm Home, where delinquent boys of the state are given into the care of the farm supervisor.
You want to lie to me?
No, sir! It was a torture chamber. Man, what they did to the kids in there was unbelievable.
No.
They sent a man.
He took me into the into the office and made me, you know, give me gear off and give me across the back and across the backside and all that sort of thing.
It was very scary for an 11-year-old, yeah. Being taken away from your family environment and going up to that environment.
I can name blokes who had been in there with me who have done murders, very violent murders, and you know, it makes me sick to think that it was probably Westbrook that caused them to do that.
The boys are taught every branch of farming, both agricultural and dairying, and are kept so busy that they do not find time to get into mischief through idleness. The discipline is strict but kindly.
Hey, come on, hurry up!
And I can remember looking up at this face snarling at me as he whipped. And I looked down at his fly area and it seemed to me that the man had a hard on.
One of the officers in the dormitory used to come and grab the boys out of the bed, take them to his room. I've seen him come out crying. And I mean crying from being raped.
You were talking, little black bastard.
The kid was collapsed on the floor and he was still giving it to him. He was an Aboriginal kid. It was terrible.
They were sick bastards, a lot of them. And they were using us boys, like I said, for their fucking enjoyment.
Jar was a holiday home compared to Westbrook.
From the orchard, we look across the downs to the wonderful stretch of fertile and beautiful country which surrounds the farm.
Westbrook under Gollidge was essentially a prisoner of war camp for children, for vulnerable children, and a place where crimes were committed against children.
That will teach you to try and escape. You're mine now. Understand.
It was a reign of terror.
Jesus Christ! Bloody stupid bitch! What the hell? How many fucking times? Come on, you little buggers! Get out!
Father and myself ended up very good friends. I forgived him, and I was no angel. I wouldn't give in to him, so I played a part of it.
As I got older, though, it got worse. Mum couldn't take it no more. She left with my younger sister. Dad drank more. We fought more. I understood why. He served in the war. He was just angry. Never enough money, never enough booze.
Well, is that your little smart ass?
He's gonna wait for
it. Would you say to me?
Dad! No, Dad, I'm sorry! Dad!
Let's see how you go now, mate.
Come on!
I was gonna shoot him, so I made the gun to shoot him. He's got black eyes and split lips and God knows what.
Where we lived in South Brisbane was okay. But without Mum, it never really felt like a home. And Dad was away half the time anyway.
I got a job on a coast of New Guinea. I'm gonna be away 3 months. Don't you get up to any mischief, because I'm not gonna be here to get you out of trouble.
Each time he went away for longer. Mostly it was just me and my older sister living alone in the house together.
It was pretty hard in a way, but we had to go out and steal the food and what we, you know, whatever we could to survive.
And one thing led to another. That led to Judge Andrews. I was 15.
I didn't steal the car. It's one of the ones you can start by pushing a button.
Alfred, you've been up before me a few times now. I sent you to Riverview, didn't I?
Yes, sir.
Riverview was run by the Salvation Army, and it was a disgrace, an utter disgrace. The floggings, the food, you name it. It all happened at Riverview.
I was hoping that might straighten you out. I could send you to Westbrook.
Westbrook was very well known, and everybody that had been in there, they were a pretty tough type of people, and it was known as a horror hole.
Your father is away, is that correct?
I'm his auntie. I'll take care of him.
I'm going to give you one more chance, Alfred. You will be indentured as an apprentice jockey. If, for any reason, you leave the job, you must tell me, or you will have broken your probation. Do you understand?
I would have thought you could have stuck at it a bit longer.
They haven't been paying me. Besides, I don't even have enough money. I was working my ring off.
I've spoken to Judge Andrews. He'll be at the court this afternoon at 4 o'clock to see you. Don't be late.
I'll be there, I promise.
And my auntie kept saying to me, I'm going to have you sent to Westbrook. So I was terrified then.
I can't give you any more time. I have to authorise the police to pick him up.
Well, I was going to speak to the judge. That day, I had to walk down and pick up a subnormal boy in the valley, opposite Wonderlegs. And there was a semi-trailer there. And I just said to him, where are you going, mate?
The semi-trailer was on its way to Melbourne. I jumped off in Sydney. A few of my mates lived in a boarding house in Glebe. I was up there for a bit. Then my mum made contact from Brisbane. I hadn't heard from her in a long time.
You've been living in Sydney?
Yes, Your Worship. But I couldn't get a job there. So my mum said it'd be all right if I came back. But when I arrived at the airport, The cops are waiting for me there.
Last time this court showed you leniency, you did not take advantage of that. I'm worried you're going to waste your life away. Perhaps Westbrook can straighten you out before you're 18.
Westbrook? Me guts was churning. 100 miles west of Brisbane. Cold. High up in the mountains. Away from everything.
Give you any trouble?
This one here, Fletcher. He thinks he won't be here for too long.
Hear that, Mr. Kohlberg? We got one of them Houdinis.
I like magicians, Mr. Gollidge.
You are?
Billy Stokes, sir.
One night, coming down from the billiard saloon, I saw a camera sitting in the back seat of a car. Stole it, sent to Westbrook.
I am your superintendent here. You are nothing. You're a waste of space, and don't you forget it. As for you, you even think of running, you'll cop this. Only 100 times worse. I'm awake to you, Fletcher. I chew wasters like you up and spit them out. Get him kitted out, Mr. Kohlberg.
Right, Mr. Gollidge.
Come on.
Welcome to Westbrook.
Many chaps that came home after serving in the Second World War. Some were suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, couldn't work. Some had, you know, physical injuries. So this really is a story about a nation also recovering from war, and as well as the lack of a welfare system.
There are usually 80 to 100 boys in the institution. It's not a prison, it's a farm training school, and is directed by the Queensland Government State Children's Department.
Thank you, Queensland, thank you. You see what you've done to people. And we all got out and done it to others, didn't we? We all got married and had children, and we took it out on them. We rebred it all, didn't we? Thank you, Queensland, thank you.
You even think of running, you'll cop this. I'm awake to you, Fletcher. Get him kitted out, Mr. Kohlberg.
Westbrook, away from everything. One toothbrush, shirt, pair of trousers, boots, pair of socks. That's it. No singlet, no underpants.
You had to wear them clothes all week. I was working in a dairy. And the mess you got into, the clothes used to stink after the first day, let alone a week, you know.
Fletcher! Fall in! You're off to the orchard.
The orchard was the worst place of the lot. You had a digging fork, and that's all you done all day was dig on a digging fork.
This is it any day, any sort of weather, any weather at all, hot or cold. It didn't matter what day it was, you still had to go out and bloody work. There was no, you couldn't go and park yourself under a tree, underneath a tree.
That's when I saw what would soon become a nightmare.
Bloody girl's flat, pick her up!
The path.
Well, you got into trouble. Usually after you got flogged, you'd spend a week or sometimes 2 weeks on the path. And it was a strip, I suppose, 25, 30 metres long, and they'd give you a clout if you wasn't going quick enough.
That had to march up and down. Every spare minute of the day that they weren't working, they had to march up and down the path.
Tools down!
Fall in! Up, two, three, four!
Wind in the shower.
It's Sunday, mate, but it's always fucking cold.
Three, four, up, two, three, four!
And you've got a hot shower. It was always cold. You could dive under for a few seconds and get out again, you know. Put a bit of soap on and get under and get out again. Some of them temperatures of the morning were, you know, 2 or 3 below zero, you know.
In the dining hall, as at play, the lads are permitted to talk and discuss as normal people.
Sit.
Dinner time. More pleasant surprises.
Reepstorf. Brace.
Bless us, O Lord, for these thy gifts, of which thy bounty we are about to receive. Amen.
Amen.
Eat.
Next chance I get, I'm going to do a runner.
The food was crushed corn and wheat, full of weevils. You had to sit there and pick the weevils out. And the meat, my mate worked in the kitchen, he told me, he says, we've got to wash the meat 2 or 3 times to get the maggots out of it before they cook it.
What is this shit?
You don't want it?
Kids were from everywhere. Some old, some new. All of them were scarred one way or the other.
Hey, Mr. Burnoff, sir, I need to use the toilet.
You had your chance, Dusik. Sit down. Right, you've got 1 hour.
You're gonna get yours, you prick. Then at least, I spotted someone I knew. Robin. From the streets of South Brisbane and Paddo. Oh. Robin Parnell.
Wondered what happened to you.
Mate, this happened.
I met Al when I was about 12, and Al and I used to tear around the neighbourhood, Al in his goat cart, his billy cart, and me on my push bike. You know, we'd get up to all sorts of things.
Me mum says I'll be out soon.
That's bullshit. Minimum 2 years. Don't believe anything anyone tells you. Once you're in here, you're stuck. I've been flogged from me arsehole to breakfast. They're a bunch of fucking mongrels. Piss off, Campbell. He's a dobber. You gotta watch them.
They were the boys that the officers were screwing. They were the officers' pets. You knew them because they were looked after, and they got, you were out working, they weren't working, they got looked after a lot better than we did.
What was that kid doing today?
I said, keep moving, keep lifting them up.
You call it the path. You mess up or get caught on the toe, you gotta walk it for hours. Boots has been walking the path for months.
A very sad story, Boots. If you'd have gone around with a tag to pin on someone for mass murder, you wouldn't have put it on Boots.
Okay, you...
The process that was going on with Boots, the likes of Boots, the intimidation, not just from the officers, but also from the fellow inmates. I mean, there were some bad buggers in there. Some of them were, you know, they were bad buggers.
Hobson ended up leaving Westbrook and worked out in some farm. He ended up shooting everybody. He shot the pigs, the birds, the mother, the father. He shot everybody.
Nobody knows we're here. Nobody cares.
Older boys are the big boys, the toughest boys, would have their girlfriends. They would be young boys, pretty young boys, and they would be, their girlfriend, you know, their wife, girlfriends, and they'd be having sexual shows with them.
That's disgusting.
Everything here is disgusting. What's that smell?
Me.
I'm a PM boy. I have to empty the officer's shit pans.
It gets on you. You can't help it. Sorry.
That's not your fault. I'm Billy.
Shongi.
Shongi went there for nothing. He ran away from home, down in Melbourne, and ended up in Westbrook.
He was a harmless kid, $10 migrant family. Came over with his mother and auntie.
He was, honestly, he was the nicest, quietest bloke I'd ever met. Minded his own business, but Jesus, they give him hell.
I'm going on the tow first chance I get.
Can't come to.
Mate, you're too slow. That Al Fisher, he's like lightning.
Well, what I was a sergeant, what they call a sergeant there. And that's sort of helping the officer to keep the boys in control.
The sergeants, they got better treated than the boys. They even got a few cigarettes here and there off the officers.
We'll get after
them. They were largely called upon to chase other kids in escapes, and in some instances, they caught other kids in escapes. In some instances, they ran in the opposite direction.
But I got a plan. I'll go early in the morning, and once I get in the bushes, they won't find me.
It's gonna be freezing.
It's gotta be cold. The cops won't come looking for you if it's cold.
Robin had had a bit of an altercation with one of the officers a while back.
I said, excuse me, sir, has anyone ever died here? In which case he said, no, Parnell, why do you ask that? I said, it's a fucking wonder. He said, I'll see you later. So that afternoon, when we lined up in the washrooms to go for our shower, he took me up to the back. I thought, oh, I'm in for a cold shower. And this is the middle of winter, it's a pretty freezing place. He said, now you get in. He then took off his belt and started to whack me.
Stop!
Well, the leather belt's bad enough, but when it's wet, when your skin is wet, it's like it's hell to pay. I was screaming. I was on the floor and I was screaming.
Please, Lord, let me bash that bastard's skull in.
Amen.
Bed.
College would sometimes sneak up and down the wards at night, and he'd write down anyone that was talking. Then suddenly at 10 o'clock at night, when you're laying in bed half asleep, in would come College.
You were talking.
Saying my prayers, sir.
Little black bastard, don't you lie to me!
Flogged the shit out of them.
You saw the difference. If they had Aboriginal blood, they got worse treatment. They seemed to get more punishments. You would get probably twice as many belt names as a white kid.
First chance I get.
Can't come to.
Mate, you're too slow. That Al Fisher, he's like lightning.
My mother died when I was six from breast cancer. Until then, the household had been pretty neat and tidy, and our lifestyle had been what I would term middle class respectable. Once my mother died, things started to deteriorate.
There was no welfare structure in Australia at the time. So for any single parents, there was no single parent's pension to help support their children.
Soon enough, the right morning to escape came for Robin. He just needed the right moment.
I said to Al, I'm waiting for the fog to build up down the bottom of the valley. I reckoned I could run that far, nearly a kilometre. I reckon I could do that first kilometre faster than any of them that would chase me. Because if you could get to that fog, you're into thick scrub all up the edge of the Razorback Mountain that was at the back there. I looked down there and there wasn't much fog. And I thought, will I or won't I?
We got a runner!
Move, move!
They took off after me in a ute down the side road to try and catch me, but I beat them to the main road and got across into a ploughed paddock. And finally I got into the fog. Once I got into the fog, I knew I was safe.
By night time, they hadn't caught Robin, but Gollidge had hold of me.
You knew Parnell was going to run, didn't you?
No, sir.
Don't lie to me, you little humbug. You knew and you didn't tell me.
No, sir, honest.
Get your pants down and bend over. Put your palms on the table. You want to lie to me?
No, sir.
Oh, sir! Hey, you want to lie to me in here? I will break you all of you!
Bastard, he lashed in, he lashed and he lashed. You're screaming out.
No, sir.
Won't do it again, you know, all this bullshit, you know what I mean? You're screaming out, trying to save yourself. But the bastard, he weren't going to give up.
Oh, sir.
He hit you a couple of times. If you didn't start saying, oh, sir, sort of thing, I wouldn't say it. And he kept going.
All of you, I will break you all!
You ended up with scabs, and when you got undressed at night time, you'd rip the scabs off again and you'd get into your pyjamas, and the next morning you'd wake up, they'd be stuck to your pants again. So it was a never-ending thing after you got a belt. And
don't worry, it gets better after a few days.
I had letters from my grandparents, letters from my cousins and a couple of different people around the area. I never seen one.
To a small clearing at the top of the Razorback. Remember, this was in the middle of winter. It was June, and it was freezing cold. I figured I'd try and lay low there as long as I possibly could, because that would make it a cold spot. You know, they wouldn't be looking for me locally there. They'd consider I'd moved on. And I always felt bad that I couldn't take Al with him, and I knew they'd punish him, and I always felt bad about that.
Oh, sir! Oh, sir!
Robin got away. He got to Sydney. By the time he got back to Brisbane, he was over 18.
By then, they hadn't changed any laws on this type of thing. If you stayed away till your time was up, good luck to you, you were free. But if you came back to Queensland, you got caught, you'd do your time.
For the rest of us, and any new bugger that had come in, the same old thing. Shit food, beatings, sergeants, dobbers,
you know you want them,
and mongrels, all fighting for the best rat hole in hell.
Yeah.
on the weekend, the officers used to make you fight other kids.
Let's go! Hands up! Finish it!
And if you didn't fight properly, the officers would bash it and make sure that you didn't fight properly.
Hurry up and finish him off!
One went down, the screws would kick the kid in the guts and make you get up again. And fight the Lord, and screws would just hang around. You'd be freaking there punching the shit out of each other until you got hardly, you just couldn't go on no freaking longer. And then you're black and blue, you're freaking, you know, it was just, that's how it was. For him, you were doing it for their enjoyment. Yeah, they were sick, they were sick bastards, a lot of them.
The home superintendent and his good wife are liked and respected by the boys.
Colberg had a couple of daughters and Goldie's had three daughters. So they didn't know what to have a son was like. They had no compassion, they were just dirty old bastards, though.
There was also a fault in underfunding of these institutions, and it seen as not a very prestigious job. So often the people that ended up working in those institutions were those who had no qualifications, not very much experience or understanding of children, and also they were left unsupervised. So therefore you have this crucible of abuse.
Every boy has his own garden plot and is permitted to sell the vegetables and flowers, thus laying by a few shillings against the day when he will be discharged.
Kids could plant vegetables and sell them to the visitors.
But if you felt hungry and you wanted a carrot and you got caught eating the carrot, you was in big trouble.
You were never, not allowed to eat your own vegetables, but you could sell them to the visitors, or you could just give them to your family on visiting day.
Visitors' Day was a big day. Saturdays, a change of clean clothes, so we all look spick and span for the outside world.
How are you, Billy? You're looking a little thin. Are they feeding you all right? Can I get you anything?
I'll go for some smokes.
Are you allowed?
Just don't let them see me.
Okay. Now you wait and see, Billy. This will be the making of you. You're going to go straight. You're going to become a good man.
Yes, Mum.
Now, I also want to tell you that your gran's been telling me that she's been writing your letters and you haven't written back.
What? I haven't...
Don't you lie to me, Billy.
I found out 50 years later that I had received birthday cards and all that. Gollidge just withheld them. He was of the mentality to cut off the inmates from their outside communications, and they were easier to control.
Got a mum?
Yeah. I don't think she wants anything to do with me.
These were vulnerable children who had endured families that had broken up because of dire poverty. The criminalisation of the welfare child. The criminalisation of vulnerable children.
How am I going to get out of here?
Well, you can kill yourself. Or pretend to. Then they'll transfer you in for a psych test into town and you might escape from there.
There you are, eh? You little bastard smoking, were ya? Eh? Get up, get up. We're off to the super.
Songbird to the office.
What have you done?
Chongy was real happy this day. He said, I'm going, Al. I'm going. They let me out. I'm going to work on a farm.
I was sad. Me mate was gone. And off he went, waved me from the Dodge on the way out.
In the 1950s, Australia didn't have this amount of children up till then. There was a need for schools, hospitals, infrastructure, and so on. But this baby boom also brought about this moral panic. this sense of what are we going to do with the juvenile delinquents, this sense of needing to keep youth under control.
There you are, eh? You little bastard smoking, were you? Eh? Get up, get up. We're off to the super.
No, sir! No, sir! No, sir! Oh, sir!
Can't believe the pain involved.
No, sir!
And I'm thinking, 10, I've got to hold on for 10. I'm counting. Ten, then it goes to 11. 15 keeps going. 20 keeps going. 25 keeps going.
That bastard thing. Freaking, they just lash up, lash up, freaking lash, coming down across your bare freaking body, across your ass, everywhere, you know what I mean? It was just unfreaking bearable.
I've seen boys get as many as 30. Not just across the backside. It was sickening, but we had to stand there and watch it. Gollidge seemed to take great delight in having the boys there to see it being done, and I still can't understand his reasoning for it.
I thought it hurt hard on the bum. On the back is unbelievable. It tears you apart. It was that point where I was just about to faint. He stopped.
And you'll never get another visit from those wasted parents of yours.
Is there anything I can do to help?
No. Thanks anyway.
Mar times. Kids were crying. Timber creaking in the cold. Like a ticking time bomb.
When you slept at night time, you had to keep one eye open or had to keep an eye on your mate or had a mate keep an eye on you because they were just full on pedophilia.
When we talked about it in the yard and at Westbrook, that was what we always said, you know, that we would rather be in jail than here.
Please, Lord, let me bash that bastard's skull in.
Smuggled a 9-bar in there and waited that night. I just got up about midnight or whatever time it was. It would have been pretty late.
What are you doing? Get back to
the... Fuck you, you prick! Ah! Oh! Will you let me go? You're a piss!
Stop! Mr. Colbert!
Juicy, stop!
Mr. Colbert! Mr. Colbert!
I got sentenced to 18 months jail, and so it took me out of the... I went down to the jail from there to Bogger Road.
Bogger Road was a holiday camp compared to Westbrook. And I'm talking about Bogger Road in the 50s and 60s, yeah. when you spent 18 hours a day in the cell and you had a shit bucket for all your toilet needs and three out in the cells, you know. That was a holiday camp.
I was put on remand for 6 weeks to Bogger Road, the state prison. I was only 15. After about the third or fourth night, I was sexually abused by a guard and two prisoners, and I was told if I opened my mouth, they'd cut me throat.
I was just going on 14, and they sent me to Bogger Road Jail for the night, and I was put in the hospital ward because I was too young to be congregating with the inmates, and about 12 o'clock, I was raped by one of the warden. I was half asleep, and he was walking in and out, and he raped me. As he finished, another bloke walked in and did the same. And that night I sat in the corner and cried. I wasn't going to do anything.
Congberg to the office.
Shongi had said the only way out was to get sent to a shrink in town for seeming to be mad. Like trying to kill yourself.
I had to give it a go.
I was going mad. Let me lie down for a while, then off to college. Would he take the bait?
You don't fool me.
It's just an act. Well, it's not gonna work. I'm not sending you to town.
Get him back out there.
You think this is hard? We're going for a while yet.
Next chance I get, I'm gonna do a runner. You wanna come? Mate, I only got 3 weeks left in this place and I'm out. Don't chase too hard, because I'll never outrun you.
Alan was the sergeant. He was a very tough man. And they had no worries with any of us with Alan, because they thought no one would be game to run away in front of him.
Four of us planned to run. Me, Reepstorf, Morgan, and little McCann.
Burnoff was the officer in charge and he was laying back under the tree. So anyhow, we bolted and Al was a bit up the back of us, probably thinking about what he's doing, who knows.
Get after him.
I took off after him and the officers said, he's catching him.
Come on, run, you bastards.
And the old said, keep going, you bastards, keep going.
I can't go any faster, I'm knackered. Fall down or something.
And Alan went straight past us.
I'm going with you.
I just went past him and kept on going with him.
I can't go any faster. I'm knackered. Fall over or something.
I'm going with you.
Fisher, you bastard!
The escape worked perfectly. Big Al Fisher came with us. We ran for about 2 miles, into the bush, into the hill. They were sounding the alarm so that every local farmer knew that there was an escape.
Come on, let's go.
We kept on running, further into the hills. The Toowoomba cops were on the hunt. They knew the place better than we did. We kept on running till nightfall.
Where do you think we are? Probably Drayton. Boys, we need a car.
Oi, the expert.
Okay. Wait here.
A couple of hours passed. We started to have our doubts.
You reckon he's done a runner?
In the bottom of the Toowoomba Range with some car, and we're doing about 85 miles an hour, and I was pleading with him to slow down to stop it. We'll get away here. Once we get over the border, we'll be right.
Yeah, boys! Let's go home! Let's go home!
Come on, let's go!
And he went faster. He was doing 85 miles an hour, at least.
Sterling Moss at your service.
Slow down, mate. We're not going to make the corner.
Stop it, Morgan. Stop it.
Oh, come on. Stop, 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 stop.
Morgan wasn't too good. Serves him right for driving so bloody fast. Reepstorf was in a real bad way.
Oh, put me down! Don't touch me! Don't touch me! Oh, put me down! Put me down!
We got the two of them that were damaged bad. We pulled the car up, and the poor man wondered what was going on. We just stood in front of the car at night, late at night, and he had to pull up.
I know it hurts, I gotta move you.
And we just opened the doors and bundled them in and said, take them to the hospital, which they did.
The next morning, the three of us hitched a ride. Nice old fella. He knew who we were. The escape was on the radio and everything. But he didn't say nothing. He just kept on driving.
We make it to prison. They won't find us.
I know this place. Shit. This is Riverview.
Alfred. I sent you to Riverview, didn't I?
Yes, sir. Riverview was the first home I was sent to. All I could think about was more beatings. We'd done a full bloody circle.
We jumped out of the car and took off. We all ran in different directions.
By then, the coppers were on the road, the river. Coppers were everywhere. So I scampered up a tree, huddled myself there. I looked down, I saw them coppers walk past.
I'm hiding in the tree, I really got away, but the police got a good distance ahead. And then the crows went and landed in the tree. And then they started screaming out, and the police eventually from a distance looked at the, up in the trees.
Busted by a crow. That's how I got my nickname, Alfred Crow Fletcher.
I seen one bloke put his hands up and stand straight in front of a train. It was all for over Westbrook.
I've heard about you, Westbrook boys.
Leave me alone.
I hope you are proud of yourselves.
Run! Stop you lot!
And everyone just panicked, and they all just ran in different directions.
We have a visiting magistrate.
It's the publicity. It's going to be an inquiry.
Ideal surroundings just outside Toowoomba on the Darling Downs is the Westbrook farm home. The boys live in open wards, and in the wards, and whilst asleep and whilst at play, are constantly under the watchful eye of those who are responsible for their conduct at all times.
How's that? You getting enough now, are you?
This church was singing Rock of Ages, clip for me, and suddenly the most horrifying scream I've ever heard. The scream was a boy that had ran away that day and hid in the haystack. They got him with the pitchfork.
Shit, you stupid little bastard.
If you got caught taking something out of the orchard, you were flogged and put in the cells. If you got caught drinking milk or eating, taking a bit of the cream, you were flogged and bashed.
There was always pools of blood on the floor that the blokes had to clean up at the next morning.
We told them that the Queensland government should have closed it down years ago, that instead of letting boys, those boys who have gone there, suffer the way they did and gone through the life of... No, it's unreal.
You were talking, little black bastard. Don't you lie to me.
Oh, you're hurting me.
I'll hurt you, bloody bastard.
We were sexually harassed a couple of times, but that's why I was bashed too. I stood up and said no. I was pretty cocky. And I was prepared to fight. And I mean, if I had to kill somebody, I would have done.
It's very easy to look at Westbrook and say, isn't it terrible what went on there? But we have to understand too that in the 1950s and 60s, there was a culture, a moral panic within our press. And if you look at the newspapers of the day and throughout Australia, there was a moral panic about juvenile delinquents.
No. There was children in there 9 years of age, 10 years of age, 11 years of age. I didn't walk around counting their ages, but they were getting molested by the big boys.
Come on, hurry up!
The boys that had toughened up, that had been there a long time, they then became, well, as like an animal. Because after a few years in there, that didn't mean nothing to you.
It was normal. Normal. That's why I had no intention to stay there for a few years.
That's why four of us had made a run for it.
We'll get after him.
I took off after him and the officers said, he's catching him, he's catching him. And then I just went past him and kept on going with him.
I'm going with you! Fisher, you bastard!
Knocked off a car. Rolled it.
Oh, put me down! Don't touch me!
We got separated. We got caught.
Went back to the watch house in Toowoomba and had to appear in court before a magistrate. Alan Fletcher was the mouthpiece, and he got up and said, we want to remand, Your Honour.
You're allowed 7-day remand three times. And that's three times, that's 21 days you didn't do in Westbrook. And you're saving the watch house in the cell.
After seeing the magistrate, I tried to unlock my handcuffs with a small bit of wire. The wire broke off in the lock.
Here, hold those.
Not a great idea.
For destruction of Her Majesty's property. Unfortunately, she can't be here, so I'm doing the work for her.
Leave alone. You okay, mate?
Show me. Is that you?
Shoggy went there for nothing. He ran away from home down in Melbourne and ended up in Westbrook.
He was the nicest, quietest bloke I'd ever met. Minded his own business, but Jesus, they give him hell.
And I was amazed, what was Shongbird doing in here? He's supposed to be out in the farm.
Shongbird, to the office.
What happened to you, Shongy? When you didn't come back, I thought they'd done you in and buried you in the bottom paddock.
The farmers had this arrangement for service, like Schomburg was sent to, and the arrangement was the farmer fed you, clothed you, and banked 10 shillings a week for you. But you couldn't have that money until you were 18.
Some of the farmers were homosexuals, or and that took the boys out on to work for them. And they would, that's what they took them out there for. And if they didn't come across, they were taken back. And they were flogged for not being good enough to the farmer. So being a young boy, I was inquisitive, what's going on? I said, Shoggy, what are you doing? So he told me the whole story.
After I was caught out that time, Gold's chum was going to work on a farm. I was wrapped. Had me own room even. I was expecting to have to sleep in the shed, but I had a proper bed with pillows and a sheet. The farmer said that his wife was sick and that he had to go to the hospital, but I never saw the wife.
They made out he had a wife, but he didn't have a wife. It was his mother that was in the hospital. He lived with his mother.
The farm was a dairy farm, and I used to have to wake up with the farm while it was still dark and bring the cows, then work the rest of the day. It was long, hard work, but nothing compared to Westbrook. But the farmer used to run me down all the time.
Lazy little bastard, aren't you? Aren't you? You got no idea, you lazy little shit.
Then they were used as fodder for a certain type of farmer. They were sent out on the farms where they were worked extraordinary hours, and if they didn't come up to par, they were sent back to Westbrook, you know, and punished again. And some of these were kids that had never broken the law in their life.
He was just standing there, looking at me. The rest of the night I couldn't sleep. He was always the same. Always talking about sex.
Cute ass. I saw her in town the other day. I could just see myself putting my hand up between those lovely legs of hers. Just about see everything when she bends down to pick up the tennis balls.
You shouldn't talk about people like that.
You don't like to talk about girls, do you?
I've heard about you, Westbrook boys. What goes on up there when the lights go out? Bit of kissing and cuddling?
Leave me alone!
I tried to be nice to you here. I gave you a nice bed and everything. But if that's what you want, fair enough. I'm going to send you back to Westbrook. You can pack your bags. I'm sending you back tomorrow.
Please.
You can go back to your little bum bandits.
He said, I snapped. And the main reason I snapped, he said, wasn't because he tried to molest me. Was because he kept threatening me to send me back to Westbrook the next day.
I was in shock, completely numb. I dumped the body, walked to Toowoomba, then hitched it to Sydney. After that, I went on to Melbourne. But I couldn't live with it. I turned myself in. Now here I am. Charged with murder.
Schoenberg was sentenced to jail for 15 years. And we wrote for many years. Then suddenly, he never wrote anymore, and I believe that's when they put him in the lunatic asylum.
Schoenberg's the greatest disgrace of Queensland government, what they did to him.
You come out of that place, honestly, you're hating the world. You're hating the world. And you put a gun in anyone's hand coming out of Westbrook, and they would have went on a shooting spree.
There were over 800 homes throughout Australia. There were at least 500,000 children who were institutionalised in Australia's 20th century. Australia had the highest rate of institutionalisation of children in the world. So some at Westbrook had run away from, say, another child's home. Because they were seen as a discipline problem, they were then sent to Westbrook for a higher regime of discipline.
We finally used up all them remands in the Toowoomba watchhouse. No more stalling now. Back to Westbrook to wait for the trial.
Police car pulled up and I remember the copper said, geez, I wouldn't like to be in your boots.
It was worse when we got back because I defied the job that they give me as a sergeant to help the officer, where I never helped him. I helped myself and the other blokes that I escaped with.
You ungrateful wasters! Alan Fisher, the most trusted boy here, let me down! Threw my loyalty back in my face! Reepstorf is in hospital and may never walk again! I hope you are proud of yourselves! Fisher, get down, now! Out of the line, down now! This'll show you what happens when you're smart, Alec. You want to escape? You're not gonna.
It was nothing to get 30 or 40 straps on the arse with the belt.
Get down, Fisher, and take it like a man.
He'd give it to them until they submitted.
The quicker you said, oh, sir, the quicker they'd stop. If you just copped it, they'd just keep giving it to you.
If you did not scream out, oh, sir, he would keep going until you did.
No, sir!
That's it!
No, sir! No, sir! No, sir!
It was like the old strap. It was about, say, two and a half, 3 foot long, and it was shaved on the end.
No, sir!
So when they flicked it, it used to take hunks of skin off your...
What's up?
Golly, he used to do his arming, you know. And I thought, well, I'll get in just when he's tired. But it was awful listening to it all going on in front of him.
You'll need to take over, Mr. Kohlberg.
So he gave it over to Kohlberg. Kohlberg didn't give you as many, but by golly, he ripped your backside. He's to flick it.
Oh, sir! Oh, sir!
And take hunks out of you. Then, after that, you're a mess. But you're so relieved it's over, and you're not really in pain because it was numb. And then, off of the hair of the horse clippers, and boom, 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 bits of our scalp missing. Then, from there, on the path.
Get the knees up! Get the knees up! Get them up! Don't trip over! Come on! Come on, get the knees up! Come on! Hop, two, three, four! Hop, two, three, four!
We were made to walk the path for weeks.
Come on!
Served breaks before work and after work, it was straight to the path. And the only way you could survive was to think of something else. For me, it was the past. When I was a young kid.
I didn't go to school. I only went to school a little while. I left when I was about 11 or 12. Got into the riverbank and ride me horses and go fishing and go home at a certain time and say, with me little bag and say, I've been to school. Yeah, had a lovely time. Oh, I used to have some good cubby houses built there. And that was, you know, you could hide under there and sleep under there. Things got a bit rough. My father, he chopped my bike up, put an axe through my bike, and so I said, it's time for you to go. And that's when I went and got the gun off me mate. 22 repeater. And I laid in bed, and I said, if he comes into this room tonight and bashes me again, I was just going to shoot him, one in each leg and one in the stomach. And being a young boy, I thought that'll stop him bashing me anymore. I don't know to this day why, but he never came in that night. I was 13.
After a while, it was time to be charged for the escape attempt. Back to me old mate, Judge Andrews.
These statements of yours claim constant beatings, assaults. This is a tissue of lies.
If your worship pleases, I can take off my shirt and show you where he beat me on my bare back.
Your injuries came from a motor vehicle accident as a result of your escape.
We're not lying, sir. It's true. You wouldn't treat a dog the way they treat us.
Fisher, you will be sent to Boggo Road Jail for 6 months.
So, well, straight from there to Boggo Road in Brisbane. It was a palace that appeared up there. Three meals a day, have water when you want it, have a shower when you want it, time in the yard to play. It was like a palace to compare to there.
The rest of you? Back to Westbrook until you are 18.
I believe you've been complaining about your treatment here.
Yes, sir.
Let's give you something to really complain about.
The officers there would know he was mad, but no one reported it. He had to give full accounts of everything he'd done to the Queensland government, which I believe he did. The Queensland government sanctioned all this. 100%.
You know what to do.
And he'd say, I hate doing this, lads. I hate it. But I've got to make you fine citizens. It breaks my heart to belches like this.
Bend your knees. Bend them.
Oh, sir! Ah!
Ah! Oh! The only way to handle it was to close your mind off. Ah! To know that one day it will all be over.
Ah! To know that other kids, mostly only guilty of just being young, had copped the same treatment from the same bastard.
Get up, palms on the desk. Get up, get up!
Oh, sir!
There was no dignity left. But they couldn't touch my pride.
Elder, get your pants up.
I was absolutely determined not to let Gollidge win. And not just Gollidge, the system, the whole system, because they let us kids down. They let the country down. I would escape again.
Hundreds of prize ribbons adorn the meeting hall. The farm is self-supporting, providing milk, butter, vegetables, fruit, cereals, etc. for the boys, as well as finance for the upkeep of the institution.
We go over and bring the meat over to cut up for stew, and we'd have to merge it. It was off, you could see it off, and you could smell it was off. And we used to have to merge it in hot water to get the maggots out so we could cut it up for meat. For the stew.
These were vulnerable children who were either the victims of abuse or poverty. Those who were placed in Westbrook were seen as needing really strict discipline.
The boy boys are taught every branch of farming, both agricultural and dairying, and are kept so busy that they do not find time to get into mischief through idleness.
We used to walk out in the morning and stand in the cow manure with bare feet to keep our feet warm, so because it was pretty cold there.
I never worked at the dairy, but what I heard, these thrashings, they used to kick the kids like a dog, just for spilling milk.
Shit. You stupid little bastard. Sir.
I dropped it and dragged me up to the office where I got another hiding from Mr. Gollidge. I think I got 10 for that, for having a mouthful of cream, as well as the kicking in the dairy.
The same at the piggery. The rapings. Horror. They was only young kids. And the shower blocks. A dangerous place for young boys.
Yeah, come on, hurry up!
Innocent or not.
Talk about pedophilia. That place was absolutely full-on pedophilia. You couldn't go to the toilet without them being there, or shower without them being, the officers being there.
The younger boys there were used for as girlfriends for the older boys. You know, they shouldn't have been there. There's no way in the world they should have been there.
Come on, fall in! Come on! Well, I've got all day! Stokes! Stokes! You idiot!
You two, stores, new pants now, on the double.
The visiting magistrate came once a month, and before he arrived, we'd all be lined up.
Sure. Stores, now.
Anyone with shabby clothes would be sent down to the storeroom to put on better apparel.
I want you on your best behaviour today! Do you understand?
Once we're all reasonably well attired, then we'd be lined up and...
Attention! Gentlemen, we have a visiting magistrate. Any requests or complaints, one pace forward.
You are a thief! You're caught red-handed stealing grapes!
I received the castor oil on a number of occasions for eating corn cobs or lettuce out of my own garden plot.
The sins of stealing and of greed! Well, if you want to taste something, taste this!
They say that we used to get a tablespoonful. Well, I can remember many times getting part of a bottle, quarter of a bottle, half a bottle.
How's that? You getting enough?
You ever taste a castle? It used to give you the shits. You used to run to the toilet. And the officers used to come in and bash it anyway.
So I will record no complaints.
Let's go.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! You'll kill him! Come on, sir. Come on. Back to bed, boys.
Get out.
Besides needing to get out, the Times was working with us a bit. A couple of the new guards leaked word of the brutal bastards to the press. It was in the papers that day, the 14th of May, 1961. We needed something to really make the outside world take notice. A mass breakout. A fire was the key to that.
We've got to burn this place down so they can't rehouse us anymore. Does anyone have any matches?
The hay shed was an easy target. Just after supper. It happened.
Run! Wait, stop! Stop, you lot! Wait, stop!
And at least 40 or 50 guys ran. They bolted. People everywhere. Put the siren on, which is big, three big foghorns.
But once they got outside, that just went out the window and everyone just panicked. They all just ran in different directions.
And we kept running through the paddocks and some got away and some didn't. Get under a house down the road and stayed there all night. And when I found this old track towards the Toowoomba Range, which I was going to jump on the back of a train going down, I was just about to turn off and the bloody police car pulled up. And he said, "Over here." And that's who I was. And I just said, "My name's so-and-so." I said, "Oh, I'm not from Westbrook." I said, "I just live across the road." So I tried to bluff it out. And they said, "Well, come and show us where you're living." So I said, "Yeah, righto." So we walked up to this lady's house and they knocked on the door. And I said, "Hi, Mum." She said, "I don't even know this place." That was the end of it. I was caught. So I was sent back to Westbrook. But a lot of boys escaped that day.
Police chase, roadblocks, front page was really full on.
We achieved our aim of getting some press. Things are about to heat up in Westbrook.
How the boys were treated at Westbrook was nothing less than crimes against children. The whippings, by golly, of the boys is illegal now, and it certainly was illegal then.
"I've been looking forward to this, Fletcher. I'm going to give you a beating like you've never had before. You wasted a lot of people's time. You've got your mates in trouble, and now you're..." "There's a problem."
"What do you mean?" "This is the last of them. By the time I'm finished with him, he'll be lucky if he can stand, let alone run."
"It's the publicity. There's going to be an inquiry."
"An inquiry? Into what?"
"Well, this place. How it's run. You."
"Who's running it?"
"A fellow named Schwarton. Listen, don't worry. We'll look after you."
"I'm not worried. They're not going to say anything."
One of the main triggers of the Schwarton inquiry there were two officers, Dooley and Bird, who were absolutely disgusted by the torture of children that they witnessed. So Dooley and Bird had nowhere to go except to the press. They leaked what they saw to the press.
"Have you or any of your staff ever beaten any of the boys?"
"Physical punishment is used only in the most extreme circumstances."
"Such as?"
"Threats to staff and other boys. Is that right, Superintendent?"
"Yes, that kind of thing."
"How was this punishment administered?"
"With a strap."
"A strap? Could you show me this strap?" "My name is Magistrate Schwarton, and I'm conducting an inquiry into this institution to see whether it has been run in a fit and proper manner. If any of you boys would like to make a representation to the inquiry on your experiences, please step forward.
Now, we need to understand that this is a climate in which there is no external complaint mechanism. There's no child commissioner. There's no place where a government organisation where you can go and make a complaint.
So.
Thank you.
There was a fatality, correct? After the administration of castor oil.
That's not correct. A boy did die after eating grapes.
Now, you can't die from eating green grapes. And I maintain that kid would have died because he got caught eating grapes, had the castor oil poured down his throat. Because they hold your head back, you'd go straight down, and once it hits your lungs, the castor oil, oh, you're in a lot of trouble. And I reckon they killed one kid there, at least, by pouring castor oil down his throat. Gollidge admits to a death from eating green grapes.
The doctor confirmed it had nothing to do with castor oil.
There have been many complaints about food.
The food's fine. My officers and me eat the same food. It's grown here.
Gollidge refused to give the officers a raise, and there was reports that the officers were stealing the food because their wages were so low.
Be clear on this. A representation means that you have your say on the conditions here. I can't believe that none of you have any issues. You will not be punished. I will see to that.
Some of the boys had their say. Then it was my go. I couldn't let my chance slip.
Fletcher is a liar and a troublemaker.
I'm not a liar. And if by trouble you mean by running away from beatings, and not with that strap, but a much longer one with a thin point that he uses, then making us walk the path until our feet are red and raw, yes, I'm a troublemaker.
I told him about the flogging from Gollidge where he ripped all me face open and bashed me unconscious on the cement floor in the bathhouse for having me hat turned up. I told him about that. I told him about the floggings, about the sexual activities, about everything I could think of.
How could you run off if your feet are so red and raw? It's just another lie, isn't it? Like a story about the bugs in the food.
There are bugs in the food. Those are from the kitchen while we were on the way back.
Your Worship, this is a fabrication.
I'm telling the truth. Let's check the kitchen out right now if you don't believe me.
So you walked in there and found the grubs all in our food. He then brought me back inside, and before he brought me back inside, I could hear what I said. He said, I hereby find this food unfit for human consumption. Then I was brought back in there, and they won't hurt you, lad. I said, I hope I'll be safe after this, because I've just dropped a lot on them.
Boy 68, absconding, 14 cuts, mocking, 3 cuts. Stealing eggs, 4 cuts. Boy 70, talking in line, 12 cuts. General humbug, 6 cuts. Boy 90, absconding, 14 cuts.
I've seen boys get as many as 30 and not just across the backside, across the back itself. You know, like, it was sickening, but we had to stand there and watch it.
John Hudson, 15 years old, 1791, Norfolk Island, 50 lashes. How is that different from the 1950s in Westbrook? It was tabled in Parliament. The Shorten inquiry was suppressed by the Queensland government for 100 years.
They say we've got to have it behind closed doors because we can't print the names of the boys who were involved. There was a lot of crap. They had it behind closed doors because they weren't too sure what was going to come out, and they wanted to smother as much of it as they could from the general public.
It reads like a Grimm's fairy tale, some perverse sort of notion of Sleeping Beauty, that you've got to put this report to rest for 100 years in a democratic country. It's quite bizarre.
This is your doing, you snake in the grass. Well, don't think you've won anything except a beating. This will all be forgotten soon enough, and you and me will still be here. I'm going to flay your hide.
I have to go to court to face charges over the escape. And I reckon they'll be pretty interested if I'm bloodied and I'm bruised.
You might buy yourself time, Fletcher, but you are going to reap the whirlwind, I promise you.
We set our peace at the Shorten inquiry. Now it was back to Judge Andrews on the charges over the mass escape.
Alfred Fletcher, I sentence you back to Westbrook until you are 18.
Two more years? No, Your Worship, that's not fair. I'm not staying, I'll leave again.
I doubt it. They're making the place much more secure. The days of an easy escape are over.
I had a ride out with Judge Andrews that day. I told him what I thought of him.
The whole show. And I said, I will not do your 2 years. And he said, you'll do my 2 years. He said, we've got a big security compound built in Westbrook now. And you'll never get out of there.
I hope you're proud of yourselves.
Oh, he was waiting for me. Yeah, I reckon I only arrived about... I didn't get enough time to get me breath, and he was into me.
Oh, sir!
Into me, left, right and centre. They had this big secure compound. Beds bolted to the floors. Lights on you 24 hours a day at night. Drilled you night and day. Cold water. It was a torture chamber. Man, what they did to the kids in there was unbelievable. You would not believe it.
Hot.
They ran them, bashed them. This went on for day in, day out, day in, day out.
Hot.
They got drill compound blokes in there from the army. And they were just drilling us night and day. And you weren't going to bloody, you had to keep going. You'd fall down from exhaustion.
You'll be heading home tomorrow to your waster parents.
Well, when I first came out, I was pretty keen to break into a shop again.
Of course, I expect you'll be back before long. Your type always is.
And that lasted for 2 or 3 years. I went to jail just for a year. Twice. But then it panned out. It panned out of it. Ended up getting a job that I liked.
I would like to think I might be wrong. But I doubt it. Get out.
Up! Hut! 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 Down! Five! Good ones! Hut! 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 Up! Hut! Hut! Hut!
doing? I tell you to stop!
Billy Stokes was lucky. Nothing changed for me.
Two, three, four.
Soon there was another escape. Ended up in Boggo Road for 3 months. I was still only 16. They tried to break me. The Black Peter, underground. The birdcage, a mat for a bed. Half rations, lights never off. Easy. Nothing compared to Westbrook. After all that pain, to thousands of boys, for all those years, the press and the Schwartz inquiry finally got rid of Gollidge. He never really got punished. He was just moved sideways to another bureaucratic posting somewhere up north. With him gone, things eased off a bit, but not my desire to escape. I jumped on a train down the Toowoomba Ranges and made it to Sydney. Got a job, did what normal kids do, smelt the air, smelt life. Then when I was 18, I come back home to sunny Queensland. But I did
send the judge a nice card. So Justice, all right, Andrews, I said, I didn't do you 2 years as I promised you in the court. And I shouldn't have been in this place in the first place.
I'm Alfred Crowe Fletcher. I'm 18. And I'm a free man.
I know when I come home from Westbrook, I did become a drinker, a very heavy drinker. I mean, I'd drink a fortnight's pay in a weekend. I was going nowhere. And until I met Mary, and I decided I'd save it a drink or my wife.
I can remember when I first got out, almost immediately you run into another inmate. The first thing you think about is, what can we steal? What can we, you know? Let's go for a joyride, you know? Let's find a car, you know? You just wanted to do that as a hit back.
I got out and sort of just become a lout, you know, trying to get reputations and all that sort of thing, you know, and fighting and that sort of thing, and thieving.
I was released at the age of 14. They drove me into Toowoomba, gave me a ticket on the train, and I got the train back to Brisbane, and lo and behold, standing on the station was my old man. And I walked up to him, and he just looked at me and looked past me and was still looking for me. He was looking for a little boy.
I can't actually remember how many of the people that I knew from Westbrook that have committed suicide from the stigma of being in there.
I seen one bloke put his hands up and stand straight in front of a train. And it was all over Westbrook.
There was a lot of boys committed suicide after coming out of Westbrook because they were drove insane. They, the brains, you know, their brains weren't the same. They just weren't the freaking same no more.
Whenever I talk about my experience in Westbrook or think about Westbrook, the butterflies come and they churn. I've tried over the years as an artist to paint them out, but it doesn't work. The butterflies still return to my tummy. That was after I'd been beaten in the shower. I guess I was wanting to show the image, the vulnerability of a naked body. The body is in pathos. It's been squeezed down by the treatment as it's whipped in the shower. But the mask is defiance. I can still face up because above me or reflected in the water of the shower is a bird outside those bars, that there's another world, there's a world of freedom. I guess that's the best way I can explain that painting.
The best part about my life is when I first hit the Gold Coast, these people that took me in, and Mum and Dad smiles. They first people in my life ever showed me love.
Anna Bly was the Minister of Families, and she decided with the Beattie government that they would formally set up a commission that would look at this, because it really wasn't what the Children's Commission's core business was. And that's commonly referred to as the Ford Inquiry.
I was very grateful that they were opening up to me. I was very grateful that they had the courage to come and talk about it, because it had been things happening many years before, and I guess they must have tried sometimes to tell people what had happened, but generally they weren't listened to. We would ask them at the end of every interview, what would you like to see come out of this inquiry? And every person said that this should never happen to another child. And I don't know that you'd ever get rid of all those scars.